Hey, this is Tuck, Ryan, and Trey from Fit for a King, and you're listening to Total Rock.
Or of Total Rock, and today I'm very excited because I'm meeting the guys of Fit for a King. They just released an amazing album called The Hell We Create. They're in Germany right now, but they're about to cross the border. As you can see, they're very excited and awake about crossing the border to the UK. Yeah. They've smashed it last night in Cologne. They're going to smash it again in just a couple of hours.
Yes.
Thank you very much for joining me. How are you guys doing today?
Pretty good. As you stated, like we told you, we're a little sleepy, but... pretty good?
Yeah, we're doing well. Just trying to catch up.
Awesome. Yep. Same. Yep.
Okay, I'm going to try and wake you up a little bit. Some interesting questions. The last 2.5 years have been crazy for everyone. We know about Ryan's story, about how things were even more emotional, and the recording of the album was probably different from any other album. Can you pick the best moment from this cycle, something that you will take with you till the end, that you will remember as a positive part of this recording, the last 2 years?
Yeah, I guess, you know, part of making the album was just, you know, with getting back out to touring, I think after having it all taken away and then getting to play again, you know, knowing Ryan's experiences and what we all went through in the few years that we were not able to perform or travel, it definitely just hits that much harder when we play now. And definitely have to like check myself sometimes on stage and be like, all right, dude, gotta get through this, you know, because it just is overwhelmingly emotional at times, but in a positive way where it's just like seeing somebody that you missed a lot. You know, it feels good.
I'd say it's a lot of that. Would it be easier if we held it?
Sure.
All right. I was going to say, because if we get all the way down here. I'd say it's a lot of the same, where even coming back to Europe can be emotional, because there was a lot of times we didn't know if we'd play shows again in our own country. So getting to play Australia and now Europe has it's been emotional, and it really makes things feel like they're closer to normal.
From this record cycle, for me, this was my first recording experience as a member of Fit for a King, so it was special for me, and just to be able to kind of sit and see what everyone's roles are and how everyone operates and works together, and try to find where I hang in the balance, you know. And I feel like it's I'm feeling like more and more integrated, you know, into the band, and it feels like I have a role that's meaningful, and I think I have a better idea of how to contribute and operate now. So it just feels like it feels like I am welcome, you know. So that's my takeaway.
And a lot of bands have already mentioned that a lot of the albums over the last year or so that were released were recorded remotely. Dropbox became a main thing. Was that a new change for you? Anything different other than that became more substantial that you're going to take with you to the next recordings?
This record process is pretty similar to the last ones. We didn't write remotely or anything. We actually hit the studio after our first tour back. So we kind of, I don't know if any of us were in a good headspace for writing during the pandemic or anything. So we kind of started the process after we were on the other side of things, where we could process what happened a lot better. And we were just in a lot happier mood, because obviously we were back to shows. And I think stress and anxiety is just not good for anybody to be productive with writing. Yeah.
I think for a lot of bands in this position, where we're all experiencing this pandemic, and you know, no one has any experience with that, right? So it's a very unique new thing for us all to go through, and you would look at it like, wow, we have all this time off. In a way, you should have so much time to create and perfect an album. But when your mental state is in a place that you haven't quite experienced as well, it's very difficult to be creative and have it be something that you think is worthwhile. So I think doing it after the tour helped us to feel much more refreshed while making new art. You know?
And the last couple of years, we've been talking more and more about men's mental health. And one of the repeating themes is about sharing. And I feel like it's kind of an easy answer, but nobody talks about receiving, being on the kind of hearing side. So how did it feel for you guys when Ryan told about everything that turned into the themes of the album, about everything that he dealt with, or when you guys are sharing and somebody on the other side is sometimes not reacting the way that you would expect them? So how does it feel either on the receiving or when, again, the reaction is not great?
I feel like for us, especially, that pretty much this whole album is centered around a lot of the experiences that Ryan went through. One, we were very, like, in a way, like, happy and, like, glad that he was sharing with us as much as he was, because it takes a lot of trust to let one person or multiple people into your life in that way and let them in on all of the good and very difficult things that you're going through. So I think that in a way it was a healthy experience. And for us, knowing Ryan as long as we have, it's nice to have him let us in like that. And it was an experience that in watching your friend go through it, we all went through the pandemic and it was very difficult for everyone. Not, you know, us, everyone outside of it. It seems like it was difficult for everyone. Ryan just had something that was different on top of it that just really threw it over the edge, that was so much more difficult than the rest of us had went through. And letting that kind of lead the way on the album, I think, was very helpful because we had a center of what we wanted to discuss and showcase. And, like, I don't know, felt therapeutic with, as a group of people, you know. It helped our communication skills a lot, I think.
Mm-hmm. Anything you want to add? Or I can...
Not at the moment, no.
On the receiving end of things, I'd say being vulnerable on a record makes it hit harder when people are just, like, straight up like, this sucks. Because you pour even more emotion and heart, and it's personal. And so I think it makes the critique, like, I can take constructive stuff all day. It's like, oh, I thought this song wasn't heavy enough, or I don't like how this was, like, the stuff. But when people are just like, oh, this sucks, this is generic, I don't like, and it's like, man, I poured, like, a lot into that. And it makes those things that normally wouldn't be a big deal, like, hit harder. I've had time to live with it, and get used to it over the last few months of the record being out. But it definitely made, like, release day more nerve-wracking because the songs were so personal, and I was hoping it would be received well more than usual. So it made the stuff like that, it took it more personally because of how personal the songs were. But I've also grown and been like, you know, those people weren't looking to find deep meaning in the song. They were just looking for something cool to listen to, and I don't need to take it personal.
Well, I do appreciate the fact that you've been sharing with the band and with the music. I've enjoyed the album, so I'm happy that it came out, and I'm glad that you guys are here. I'm really excited about the show tonight. Another theme that was around the main story is kind of criticizing society, whether it's ourselves or the people around us. And one of the songs that I really enjoyed is about the kind of the celebration of misinformation around us. Do you feel like there is a bitter end to it? Are we spiraling out of control? Is there a light at the end of this weird tunnel? Or are we just going to celebrate the who shouts louder?
I'm loud. You can go.
I would say I don't know if there's an end to it, because spreading misinformation is easier than ever. There's so many times you'll see a story on the internet, react to it, and then be like, find out it wasn't even true, like, a week later. But it even comes to, like, misinformation, whether it's news sources, politicians, religion. There's a lot of churches, and as I research, like, churches have, like, twisted things or taken out whole books of things, and, like, they have their own translations. Politicians, we all know, we don't have to go into detail, we all know politicians lie constantly. And I think people in general are spreading it because everybody's so eager for a click or so eager for reaction on the internet that even when they're not meaning to spread something that's not true, it's just a reaction.
It's the same thing that, like, rumors, people just want to spread things and react to things and have, they're more excited about their reaction to something than whether it is true or false. They want to be a part of the mob. They want to just generate more, get more, those clicks absorbed onto their page because it's, well, if this is really hot right now, well, if I participate on it, maybe I'll be hot too. And it's just gross. You know, I think it's one of those things that the more that you sit back and see it, if it just feels very soulless, and it's hard not to see it. So, you know, that's certainly something that I think all of us can exercise is getting away from it.
I grew up believing that knowledge is power. Do you think that it's still the case, or is it influencers or followers are power? Truth. Anything change?
I think we should just change it to truth is power, right? Where knowledge is starting to be skewed, where people think that there will be things that people absorb as knowledge, but it's actually false. Therefore, it's not. So maybe truth and statistics are power.
We're going to redefine objectiveness later. Yeah. But let's touch on something that I feel like is going to be even more personal for you guys. The genre of the band, I don't know if you accept it or not, but you've always been associated with Christian core and those lists and those scenes and everything. Did your faith change over the last 2.5-3 years of challenges, personal, global? Was it easier for you to find belief, or did you question anything? Where did you move on that spectrum?
I'd say I don't, as probably as of a while ago, I don't feel comfortable calling ourselves a Christian band or anything, because I don't sit and write and say, all right, time to write Christian music or time to glorify God with our music. Like, I'm not gonna lie and be dishonest to people. I play music because I love playing music. I write music because I love writing music. I am a Christian, so sometimes that will be in lyrics. Same with everyone else in the band. But even, like, we have members of the band who aren't Christians at all. And on top of all that, I just want to write honest music. And some people, I think I don't have less faith in my own Christianity, but I have less faith, I'd say, in the institutions of Christianity over the last few years, and like the perversion of a lot of things in order to push agendas. And honestly, we've all seen like Christianity being used for like hate and using it as like a way to feel superior to others instead of being loving and accepting. And I think some of the most negative interactions I've ever had on tour are with other Christians. And it hasn't changed my faith because they're human. Like, my relationship's with Jesus. It's not with all these people and all these churches and stuff like that. So I don't know if you have.
Like Kirby said, I think over the past few years, I'm a bit disillusioned with the institution of church. But I'm still a Christian, and I think everyone's faith is their responsibility to wrestle with individually at the end of the day. And I think you have to kind of like, you kind of have to sort through, you know, I think you have to trust your gut, and you know, we call that the spirit sometimes, depending on how you view it. But it's like, I think you just have to do what you feel is actually what Jesus would do. I know that's a cliche term, and make sure it's like kind and compassionate and true, and it's not like self-preservation at the expense of others, because that's kind of the opposite of, I think, what we believe. But yeah, I don't know. It's the institution of it, I think, has become messy over the few years, because you see a lot of loud fundamentalist people that tend to have some kind of extreme, unkind views. And I think we've just seen too much. Like we've been around too many different groups of people and different races and cultures and different languages. Like we just know too much to have that kind of like that tribalism mentality where it's like, I know and believe the one right thing, you know? So I think we're all pretty open, and we're not the kind of people that like judge or treat people differently because of what they believe. We tour with people of all different kinds of beliefs. So
in a way, like, not saying that this is just me, but in a way, like, it's hard to tour the world, and like, not saying we've done the whole world, we've gotten to travel a lot, right? And be that we, it is something that has come up in our youth and what we've built the foundation of our band on, it does come up a lot. So in order for me to fully embrace that, and in a way, like, you know, be Christ-like, right? When you talk to people from all over the world, all different religions, but a lot of people back home, they would say that those people are all wrong. They don't know what they're talking about. They're not Christians. They're not this. They're not that. Or they're false. They're not going to go to heaven. Like, and things become so cut off that at this point, I just want to have my faith and not be, like they said, like, be as focused on necessarily being a part of the institutionalized idea of, well, you have to go to church and you have to do all this, where, you know, I guess when the world shut down and stuff, my conversations with God more became about, like, well, what did I do wrong that maybe brought me here? And what can I do to maybe like correct my ways and try to better myself, that if I'm given the opportunity to continue to pursue music and it's given back to me again, how can I show greater appreciation for the gifts that have already been given to me? And I think that at this point, all of us just don't want to, like, I don't want to be cut off from someone because they think that I don't like them because I'm a Christian, or I don't want them to not like me because they come from a different religion. Like, I'm just here to try to spread like faith and love through whatever ways in which we do. And, you know, Christian or not, we just care about other people and want them to feel welcome to spend time with us.
Yeah, I think we all kind of feel like if someone were to ask us, like, if we're Christian blatantly, we're kind of hesitant because we're like, well, what do you mean? Because we probably don't.
Your idea of what a Christian is could be very different.
Yeah. Yeah, just in the U.S., there's so many different ideas of what a Christian is. All over the world, there's so many different ideas of what a Christian is, where I think as I got older, it got to be one of those things where, like, you talk to your dad or something, and he's just like, well, dude, I'm teaching you that stuff, and I'm bringing you to church because I care about you, and I want you to be a good person. We're not fighting against nobody. We're just trying to live a good life, and as are they. And I think that if more people spent more time trying to live more of like a universalist kind of love for each other, you know, that, hey, you have faith, I have faith, we may see our faith differently, but what a beautiful thing it can be, rather than causing so much strife and fighting all the time, you know?
First of all, guys, thank you very much for your openness and honesty and sharing about that. And I feel like if I sum up kind of all your answers, I feel like what you're saying is just be kind and question some things, whether it's about information, about what you think people are. Yeah. Just ask questions, be open to answers, be open to differences, and be kind. Yeah. So just share that and enjoy some loud music all together.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, you look kind of like the singer of 1975.
Okay, I'm okay with that.
Right?
Yeah.
A little bit.
I've been called worse things, so I appreciate it.
He's handsome as hell. What are you talking about?
Thank you. Okay,
what a stud.
We're going to finish the interview here and just continue flirting with each other. I have one rumor that I want to confront you with. There is a rumor online that you guys came on this tour only to stalk the cast of Dark, and you're going to go around Germany and look for the locations and all the actors. Was it just about Kirby?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not stalking anybody. I personally don't even know any of the actors' names. It'd be cool if they came to a show. I mean, I haven't looked them up. But I want to confirm, I have not stalked anybody.
Yes. Some of the lyrics are influenced.
Yeah, right? The song Reaper is heavily influenced by Dark. Okay. I love that show. It's my favorite show.
Did you know that it's all shot in Berlin?
I did.
Okay, so if anything happens and Kirby goes missing in Berlin and he misses the show, then that's the reason.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. I don't think it's not a real city, I think, in the show, right?
I think it's just the outskirts of Berlin. I mean, yeah. It is based on...
It's a made-up city, but it's in Wieden.
But I think it's all shot in Berlin, so if you miss the Berlin show, we know why.
We'll have to get access to his Apple tags so we can know where he's at all
times. It'll be in a different time.
Yeah, you will have transported back in time or something.
Yeah.
I don't know how the show...
There's going to be two of me. There's going to be one.
At least two.
Yeah, at least two.
Okay, so on that weird note, guys, first of all, thank you very much for your time and your openness and the album. I really enjoyed it. I cannot wait to see you guys shred it on stage. Is there anything else you want to say to fans out there before we say goodbye?
Be nice. Thanks for listening. Love you. Hope you're having a nice day.
I want fans to know that I watched Dark in German with subtitles. No English dubs.
Respect.
I heard it.
What about Squid Game?
Same. I listen to it in Korean. Don't listen to the dubs. They're bad.
I don't know. Love you guys. I'm glad to be here in Europe again. Haven't been since 2017, so thanks for coming.
What's your favorite German dish?
It's got to be a solid brat, I guess.
Yeah.
Some sort of wurst.
Yeah, wurst.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, don't forget to check out The Hell We Create. Great stuff. Check them out on tour. They're in the UK if you haven't seen that after the tour ends. But, guys, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure talking to you and diving into your world.
Thank you, Matt Healy. It was a pleasure. I'm glad you're the 1975s.
I'm glad I'm the 1975 as well. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.